distinct honor and privilege to move us forward and introduce to you Ms. Cindy Steinbeck. Last summer, the chair and his dear wife, Edith, had the blessing of traveling in Central California and visiting the new wine country, specifically Steinbeck Winery and Vineyard. Mutual friends introduced us, but our friendship was instantaneous. Cindy is a fifth-generation Paso Robles, California farmer working with her parents and her brother and son at Steinbeck Vineyards and Winery. She shares ownership with her family in their various businesses and serves as director of marketing and sales and public relations. Cindy launched educational tours in her vineyard using a vintage Jeep that she grew up driving, which is really cool. I've driven in it. She also created the family wine brand. Cindy has written The Vine Speaks and The Grapes of Grace. Which I just happen to have here. And she is willing to sign those for you if you want. She did not, however, write the book, The Grapes of Wrath. Different Steinbeck family. However, she may be working on the book, Wraths of Grapes, so I'll let you talk about that. Her writing reflects her passion for the vineyard and scriptures, which she communicates at an in-depth level, especially on Jesus' words from John 15, I am the vine. Cindy holds a Master's of Art in History and Theology from Concordia University, Irvine, where she also serves now on the Board of Regents. Cindy's diverse life as a vineyard owner, farmer, teacher, business strategist, writer, mom, and grandma has provided amazing life experiences from which she tells her touching stories with great humor. Her passion for God's word and work is the foundation of her thinking, writing, and being. I hope you will be inspired. Please join me in welcoming my friend, Cindy Steinbeck.
It's such a privilege to be here, President Walton, Edith, so wonderful to be here. It's an amazing journey coming from Paso Robles, California, to Florida, Georgia District, to be here with you to present a little tiny bit of my heart in the vineyard and what I have seen over these last years. My journey took me from this very ranch as a farmer to Concordia, Portland, got my degree as a DCE, then I journeyed to various cities working as a DCE, and then God called me back home. So I retired, began working with my father in our vineyard in Paso Robles. On this property, there are 300,000 grapevines in our 500 acres. As you can see, the beautiful rows, the beautiful vistas in Paso Robles. So some of you may not know where Paso Robles, California is, so I brought this map. Paso Robles is exactly halfway between San Francisco and LA. On the Highway 101, only about 30 miles from the coast, it's a beautiful wine region. I am not related to the author Steinbeck, although I am an author Steinbeck, so we'll have to get that straight. My father, Howie Steinbeck, my grandson, Bradley Newkirk, my son, and myself are the four generations blessed to live on the property. All in all, we're seven generations in Paso Robles when you include my 3.5-year-old grandson now. It's such a joy and a privilege to get to carry forward the family story. They moved to Paso Robles from Geneseo, Illinois because of a tiny newspaper article that said, good farmland, cheap, and we're looking for families to help us start a Lutheran church. So they sold everything they had in 1883 and moved out west. Christmas Eve, 1884, is the year they settled in the area. This is the old Jeep that President Walton referred to. My dog helps me drive. We make our way through the fields in this Jeep. And it's an amazing privilege when people travel across the country and I get to drive that Jeep and speak the word of God from my perspective in that Jeep. But even more joyous for me is when God brings people down my driveway to taste wine, and they get into this Jeep, and they may be unchurched or dechurched, and they say, "Cindy, you're so passionate." And I say, "You have no idea about my passion, because I love the fields and the vineyards, but I love the vine. And I love being a part, being grafted into Christ Jesus, the true vine." We welcome guests and visitors from all over. And we stand at the vine, and I describe the parts and what I've seen in my 20 years of working in my father's vineyard. And it's dusty, and we get soil on us, and we pick the soil up and we touch it, and we talk about the depth of an old vine like this, maybe as much as 10 feet deep, the root system. And we talk about rejoicing as branches of the vine. When we talk engaged in the master's business, I think about 18 years ago moving home to engage myself in my father's business. Mom and dad have been on the property their entire married life. And my dad, Howie Steinbeck, received the property as a gift from his parents. And they received that property as a gift from their parents. And so my dad, as you see, walks the fields. He drives the fields. He is the vine dresser from which I've learned a little bit about what Jesus may have been saying in John chapter 15. A key verse today is John chapter 5, verse 17. Jesus answered them, "My Father is working until now, and I am working." And that verse has been instrumental as I've grown up, not in the vineyard, but grown up in my faith in the vineyard over the last 18 years. I watch my Father work, and I work the work he works. And as his daughter, I drove tractor for 12 years, going back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, 10, 12 hours a day on a tractor, or doing the irrigation. 500 acres of vineyard is equivalent to 400 miles driving back and forth. So if Dad says, "Go mow this acreage," and I go back and forth on that property, I go 4 miles per hour. That's a lot of tractor hours to mow the field or to spray the fields. Also from John chapter 5, John reflects, "This is why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal to God. So Jesus said to them, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of his own accord, but only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, that the Son does likewise. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all that he himself is doing.'" These verses open my eyes to the fact that when Jesus healed the sick, raised the dead, he was watching his Father's work, and he was working that work. So when we are engaged in the master's business, what do? We watch Christ's work. And we work that work knowing that Jesus watched his Father's work and he worked that work. We are his hands and his feet and his voice in this world. So to be engaged, what does that mean? And when Greg and Edith were bouncing around in that old Jeep, I had a pocket knife in my pocket because that's what farmers carry, is pocket knives. And so I took that knife out and said these words. Jesus said, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." So what does the word abide mean? To remain, to continue, to stay, to be in a particular attitude or relationship. Jesus says, abide in me. We won't be spending time on this today, but there's the second half of the abides in me and I in him. It's already been spoken that Jesus abides in us, but today we're focusing on abiding in him. So every one of the 300,000 grapevines on the property looks like these. From the nursery, that tiny vine on the right side is delivered to us. It's almost a year old already. So you can see the little sticky tape. It kind of looks like glue about halfway up that plant, just below the leaves. Every single plant looks like this when it comes to us from the nursery. The part above that sticky tape is what I call the branch. And below that is called rootstock. Now, the rootstock is a non-fruit-bearing grapevine. They were discovered in New York in the late 1800s, where the vine that was perhaps Cabernet Sauvignon got diseased, but the non-fruit-bearing plant was not diseased. Now, we've discovered that a non-fruit-bearing plant was planted by a bird that probably pooped out the seed. And a seed, if you plant a grape seed, you will get a non-fruit-bearing plant. But if you take a cutting and put it in the ground, the tiny little buds grow roots down, and the other buds grow roots up. So at the nursery, they take the tiniest little bud, and at every leaf on every grapevine, on the opposite side where the leaf is attached, there's a bud that looks just like this. And they can be tiny, but they can be a little bit bigger, but they're very, very small. Wound up in every single bud on every single plant is all of the shoot growth and the fruit growth for next year's crop. So the grafters take a very sharp knife and they cut a deep slice in the flesh of the rootstock. Now, rootstock is not susceptible to drought. It's resistant to salt. And it's also resistant to the disease they call phylloxera. And it's a nematode that lives in the soil that eats the outer core of the root and kills the plant. So that rootstock is the host home for that tiny little bud that's grafted in. So at the nurseries, they take, let's pretend from here down is the rootstock, and the roots have already been growing in the soil for a full year. And they cut a deep slice into the flesh of the rootstock, and they cut a little tiny bud away from Cabernet Sauvignon, and they place the bud into the flesh of the rootstock. Then they put that Band-Aid around it, and the bud bleeds, and the vine bleeds, and they form one flesh. And that's what you see there, is the Band-Aid is wrapped around that rootstock where the bud is placed in there. The rootstock would continue to grow, but they chop it off, because it's now the branch's job to grow up and become the trunk of the plant and then get trained onto the wires to become the branches of the vine. And so that bud is placed into that space. Peter said, he himself bore our sin in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds, we have been healed. Christ Jesus is our rootstock. He is not susceptible to sin, death, or the devil. We have been cut away from the old and placed into the holy life of the rootstock. He lives eternally. He was before the foundations of the world. We are taken from our original cutting that could have been a grapevine, but susceptible to disease and all of the factors that we deal with in the vineyard, cut away and placed into Christ's holy life. This analogy breaks down slightly because only one bud is grafted into one rootstock. But in fact, you and I together are grafted into one Christ. That's why when we hurt each other, it hurts so much, because the healing has taken place and we're tearing at that scar and that wound. When Peter says, by his wounds, we have been healed, that is a past tense statement. It is a reality of our lives that we have been healed. And we know that's a quote from Isaiah saying about, talking about the good shepherd. So when we're engaged in the life of the vine, it is a flesh-on-flesh relationship with the true vine, in the true vine. Christ's work grafts us into his life, binding us to himself. Now, grafting is a once-in-the-life-of-the-plant event. Baptism is a once-in-our-life event that does just this, grafts us into his holy life. Paul in Romans 11 says, if the root is holy, the branches are holy. Dennis was a trusted mentor in the Paso Robles wine industry. Dennis's kidneys began failing, and I knew he did not know Jesus. He was an outstanding citizen of our community, as well as highly acclaimed in the state of California wine industry. But Dennis didn't know Jesus. And when I visited him in the hospital room, I knew he was in his last days. And I said, Dennis, may I share my heart with you about my faith? And do you know that in one sentence about grafting, Dennis owned a vineyard. In one sentence about grafting, I was able to tell him who Jesus is and where his life was in Christ as he came to faith in him. Now that's my example from the vineyard. I believe it's our calling to empower, as we engage in the master's business, to empower the people, ourselves, God, ask God to empower us, but empower the people in our parishes to learn their own stories so that they can, in a very quick time, say the crux of the Christian faith. Now, Dennis's wife came running to me in the hallway 2 weeks later and wept on my shoulder. And my first assumption was that her husband had passed away, and I was wrong. She and her husband that day had made the decision to take him off life support. And her words to me were, Dennis has decided to go home. That's what grafting speaks. And this is baptism, But it said a different way that people in my culture of wine in California who don't know Jesus can understand in a heartbeat when we're in a Jeep ride on that 300,000 acre or vine vineyard. Because we're surrounded by the story. And the story is we have fellowship in Christ with God. And we also then, in a very profound way, have fellowship with one another. So my grandson and I, on wet winter days, go play in mud puddles. And my question for you is, can my grandson play with me outside without engaging in this mud puddle? It is not possible. What you need to know is that Grandma prepares ahead of time. And I make plans for at least a 30-minute bath after the mud puddle experience. Because he and I join in the mud puddles together. And when you think about our Christian lives, can we, in Christ, grafted in, which, by the way, is a painful, messy experience, there's cutting and bleeding and dying involved, can we jump in the Word of God together and rejoice in the messes, in the mud, in the mire of life together? Because see, while I was taking a photo with my iPhone, I was standing in this mud puddle with him and letting him watch the splashes not only go on himself, but also on me. How about this one? He was going to be the ring bearer at a wedding, and I got to babysit before the wedding. So what does Grandma do? Takes him outside with a bucket, and he's picking up rocks in his little tuxedo. Think about how engaged a three-year-old is when they want to learn something, and they want to be engaged in every way. So in the first circumstance, the mud puddle, I was not telling him, don't get dirty. But on this instance, I was saying, you know, hold back just a little bit here, Bradley. Can we together engage? One of my favorite photos, this is the scriptures, Christ coming out of the pages to hold this young lady. Can we, as we engage in the Master's business, do this to one another? Maybe not physically, maybe emotionally. This is engaging in the Master's business. I submit to you, if you're like me, that it's easier for you to stand next to someone and reach out to hold them as opposed to allowing them to hold you in time of need. Janine was dying of breast cancer, and I went to her home 2 days before she passed away. And I climbed in bed with her, and I held her, and I prayed with her, knowing it was going to be the last time I would spend time with her. And we prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed some more and cried more after that. And when I got done with the prayer, I came back just a little bit so I could see her face. And I said, Janine, just know that Jesus is holding you. And she said, I know he is because you are. It's messy to go be with someone. It's messy. It's even messier to ourselves when someone needs to be Christ to us. I submit that we have a crisis going on in this society of people feeling used. And when they're done being used, they feel like they need to be thrown away. And we need to engage in the Master's business, welcoming them to allow us to be Christ's heart and hands and arms and feet to them. And it's hard to receive, especially when you feel used and abused. But it's worth it to convince people that they have their value simply because they are a human being. Because most people get their value by what they do as a human doing. But we all know that our value is in our being. The Pharisees wanted to kill Jesus after he had called Zacchaeus, the tax collector, out of the tree. But they couldn't get close to him because all of the people were hanging on his words. In Luke 18, just before that, Jesus approached the blind beggar whom all of his followers were telling to be quiet, and he wouldn't. And Jesus said, "What do you want me to do for you?" That is a hard question. What do you want Jesus to do for you? That's a hard question. You might easily be able to answer what you want him to do for your congregation or for your family members, but how about for you? And in John chapter 5, just before the verse that's my favorite, where Jesus says, "I watch my Father's work and I work," Jesus asked the man at the pool, "Do you want to be healed?" His answer to Jesus was, "I don't have anyone to put me into the water." Jesus said, "I didn't ask you that." Jesus didn't say, "Do you want me to put you into the water?" He says, "Do you want to be healed?" Now, we all know that 1 Peter 2:24 says that we have been healed. But that continued healing is what the vineyard has taught me. Is that every year, I'm going to skip forward. Oh, no, I'm not. The healing that we beg for may be of our bodies. But what about our emotions and our heart and our soul, our mind, our senses, and our spirit? Just as the convention broke at noon to go get a box lunch because we need nutrition, so each and every day we are called to have the Word of God and our lives feed us on many, many levels. So as we fulfill our vocation in this world, these are some of the aspects of being a human being, to celebrate, to feel, to heal, to listen, and to follow. That is just a tiny list God calls us to as human beings in this world. This photo is one of my favorites. That wound that you see, that is sap dripping from a wound that is not yet scabbed over. Coming out to the right of that main spur is the new bud growth. So this is what the vine looks like after being pruned. Just a couple of buds on each spur. That new growth is going to grow 3 feet of canopy. And remember I said all of the fruit is wound up right there for this coming year. Those drips of sap drip just a short amount of time before that scab quickly forms over that wound. Now, you and I know that when we cut ourselves, we let it bleed a little bit, we wash it with water, and then we put a Band-Aid around that. When my 3-year-old grandson gets a cut, what does he do? He runs to me for help so that I can kiss his boo-boo. With many of us, the very people we could have or should have been able to run to kiss our owies, our broken hearts, were those that may have hurt us the most in our lives. What about those people that have been deeply wounded by the church? Who is going to kiss their boo-boos? They're not going to come to us. Nobody that gets in my Jeep to ride around is opposed to me talking about Jesus. But almost everybody, unless I know that their church background, is opposed to me talking about the church. But nobody is opposed to me talking about this. Here are Paul's words. What is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might, that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places? This photo shows me that verse. The power of God that raised Jesus from the dead is at work in you and in me, and that's what it looks like. The sap flowing brings nutrients, healing to the plant. Just as the blood of Christ cleanses us from all sin, it heals us and it keeps us engaged in his life from now until eternity. And in the picture of grafting in Christ Jesus, we live in his holy lives, in his holy life now. And we also live in his holy life for all eternity, which is now. So that even when we die, where are we living? In Christ, in his life. This photo kept me alive during some very dark days in my life. Because I knew I was living an unhealthy marriage. I just didn't understand it, because as a DCE and my husband, the worship team leader, we would go to church on Sunday mornings, and it was an act. And we would come home, and things would explode. And on Monday through Saturday, the home was not a safe, healthy home. And on Sunday morning, the same thing would happen. And I began waking up to that about 10 years ago. And as I woke up to that and attempted to get my husband to engage in the business of being engaged, being a healthy spouse, the abuse got worse. Trapped in cars, trapped in rooms, not able to be a human being. And as I looked at this photo over years' time, I had to ask really hard questions, like Jesus asks of each of us, do you want to be healed? And I would say to God, no, I want to be married, because that's what God wants. And as I was dying in my house, this picture kept me alive with the hope that God was at work in me. And when I finally had courage to say no more and to get professional help and to cry out with my whole being to my family, who knew nothing of what was going on. They knew things weren't right, but I was always up and always moving. And by the way, I was always serving everyone else. This kept me alive, as did these verses, because Paul said to me, not me toiling to save others, but Paul toiled, for this I toil, struggling with all his energy that he powerfully works within me. Paul wrote those words for me and for you. I know your story is different than mine, but we all want to keep everything scooped together in a perfect life so the world will see our lights, but that doesn't happen. The world sees our hypocrisy, not our authenticity, because I couldn't be authentic. I was dying in my house and I couldn't admit it to anyone because I was a trained DCE and had a master's degree in theology and everything was supposed to be right in my house. And I believed if I just confessed more and was just a better person, that I would be okay and my family would be okay. We are okay, and what I prayed for 29 years has come to fruition, but I live alone. My children have come to grips with this circumstance that they have a divorced mom. But I know that God wanted me alive in his kingdom, engaged in his business. And I was called from death into life. Ephesians 2:10 says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared in advance that we would walk in them." That little bud that we cut away has all of the fruit and shoot growth for this coming season, 2016. This is what Paul was talking about. You and I have within us everything the vine dresser is calling forth. It's there. It's Christ's job to work on us, to thin and to prune and to call us to health. My father, the vine dresser, makes some hard decisions in the vineyard. And it's not pretty sometimes, but the vine dresser knows what's best. And he knows that it's our calling in this life to pay attention to all aspects of our being, not just our minds, because we can all speak from our head. The question is, can we speak the message of the gospel from our hearts? And are our people being energized to tell their stories of authenticity and hope and reality and life in him? As I'm standing here, I'm not sure you have seen this. This is a beautiful piece here in front of us. The baptismal font. In John chapter 7, Jesus said, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." And we know he was talking about the Holy Spirit that dwells in us, sustaining our lives in him, both now and for eternity. This world is dying to hear the message clear and profound, the connection with the soil and the water and the word and life as we have it in Christ Jesus. As we engage in the Master's business, we are called to know who we are according to Psalm 139. We are to lay our burdens aside and look up to the hills from whence comes our help. When I was in the deepest, darkest times, when I would walk in the vineyard, my shoulders would be turned over like this, and I would be looking down at every stone on the path. And as we know in the story from Luke 24 on the road to Emmaus, that they didn't recognize Jesus because they were downtrodden, and he kept them from seeing him. But we know that they recognized him in the breaking of the bread. And they ran to tell the story. When Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, Jesus said, "Take away the stone." And Martha said, "Jesus, it's gonna stink." And he said, "That's not what I was talking about. Take away the stone." And we, when Jesus comes in to perform resurrections in our lives, we say, "Well, Jesus, wait a second. It stinks. I gotta cover this part up." And he says, "Cindy, come forth." Our value is in being a human being. And when we have been downtrodden to the point where we believe we have no value and that life is not of value, we can hear those words come forth from those rivers of living water, whether it's directly through the Word of God or whether it's through people walking alongside us. But people in this world need to hear you say, "Come forth." But if you don't know yourself and you don't know and see the brokenness that may have been caused by those people that were supposed to kiss your boo-boos, but instead they may have slapped you for being wounded, we've got to know those things about ourselves so that we can truly engage in the Master's business. This picture of this rushing river down the waterfall in Yosemite National Park and seeing the refreshing nature of that water that's flushing through, we ask God's mercy in our lives to help us to see how he is calling us to be human beings as we engage in the Master's business. This photo is a little bit challenging to see, but right here, it's a 33-year-old grapevine. You can see here the face of Christ hanging off down and to the right. And then the chest, legs here, arms lifted up. This is a 33-year-old grapevine in my vineyard that my guests and visitors pass every time they drive down my driveway. And I pass by it every time I drive down my driveway. Knowing that God's mercy in this world is real. It's challenging to see. I have a Giclée painting of it where an artist actually put a little tiny crown of thorns there on the face of, on the head of Christ as it lays to the side. We are called to be engaged in the life of the vine, grafted in to his holy life. We have died, and our life is hidden with God in Christ Jesus, both now and for all eternity. I encourage you in your walk in Christ Jesus to recognize that's where you live, you dwell, you remain, you have a relationship with Christ, and that the vine has a relationship with us, as he lives in us. So we, as Paul says in Colossians and Ephesians, we are rooted and grounded in Christ's holy life, both now and for eternity. I am so honored to be in Florida at the Florida-Georgia Convention. I love you, Waltons, for coming to my place, letting me get to know you and to share my life with you. And thank you as well for this opportunity. God's rich blessings in Christ.